may be seated. As we've gathered together today, we come in the great tradition of the church celebrating that first day that Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to guide the disciples out. I think as we look at that, as we look at our thought process for the past few weeks of working through this acronym of Bell's Blessing Eating, we're still on the eating part. And as we look at that, I believe the Holy Spirit plays a major role. The Holy Spirit came at a time the disciples were gathered around a table together. Our scripture today we're going to look at involves food and water, but not just any kind of food and water, living water. The water that Jesus Christ gives us that we never get thirsty again in Jesus' word in our scripture. We also come today to celebrate Memorial Day, our veterans that gave all. And I believe as we look at that, it's appropriate today to celebrate the two together, because our veterans went bravely and boldly in to serve in the world. They didn't hesitate. They didn't question. They went and they did. And I believe that we're called to do the same. And the Holy Spirit is what gives us that inner courage, that strength to go without question, that strength to dive in and follow God's word. Today we get an example of just how to do that through what Jesus did to the Samaritan woman in a well. So if you'd like to follow along with me, our scripture today comes from the book of John, chapter 4, starting in verse 1. And this is what is written. The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. When the Lord learned of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it was that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his flocks and his herds?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. And Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is that you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he." Let us pray. Dear Father, we come to you this morning asking that you would open this scripture to our hearts, that through your Spirit you would guide us to use these words to live them out, to teach them to others, and to go into the world sharing your grace and your hope. We pray these things in your name, Lord. Amen. So we come today with a story of Jesus, a story that we look at, and as Jews would have saw this story, they would have said, "This cannot be the Messiah." See, at the time, Jews would not speak to Samaritans. let alone ask them for a drink or take water from them. Samaritans were kind of that lowly group of people nobody wanted to be associated with. But where does Jesus set up ministry? Right there. In the heart of a place where nobody would go and nobody would minister to. Jesus goes to a place that he knows people are in need. Jesus goes to a place where he knows he's going to affect a life and make it better. Not for him, but for them. For the people around him. So Jesus goes in, sits down at a well, and waits. And it says that a woman approaches the well with her buckets, her jars, her tubs to get water. Now we look at water in this scripture and we can say water is many things, but in the end, water is what sustains our life. I don't know about you, but on a hot summer's day when you're out working in the yard, nothing makes you feel better than a tall, ice-cold glass of water. It quenches the thirst. It's what you need. It's what your body craves. It wants water. It wants liquid. And so Jesus goes to the center of town in this town, Sychar, and hangs out, and this woman shows up. And as she walks up to the well, Jesus nonchalantly says, "Hey, can you get me a drink?" Innocent question, right? You've probably asked it to people many times yourselves. You've been thirsty, you've been tired, you've probably walked into your home and said, "Can somebody get me something to drink?" I know I've said it out working in the yard, and Maddie will come out for something and say, "Hey, could you get me a drink?" I don't care what it is, just something, I'm thirsty. This is the question Jesus poses to this woman, who we're never given her name, but we're told she's a Samaritan. And the Samaritan woman looks at Jesus and goes, "You're a Jew, right? I can't do that. You know I can't. I'm not allowed to talk to you, much less get you a drink." But Jesus looks at her and says, "Well, if you knew who I was, instead of telling me what you couldn't do for me, you would have asked me to give you a drink. Living water." And the woman looks at him, and most obvious as I think any of us would have said, "And how are you going to do that? You don't have any buckets, you don't have any ropes, the well's deep. I don't know how you're going to get it out of there." See, friends, this is where ministry starts. I think this is the point that we need to start to look at as we look at doing ministry in our lives. Jesus picks a place. It can be any place, but in this scripture, it's a place where people come for sustenance of life, a place to get water, around a table, if you will. And he sits there and he waits for somebody to come by, Jesus being fully God, knowing who it's going to be. And he asks this woman, "Could you give me a drink?" What an easy question. What a simple way to start the message of salvation. "Could you give me something to drink?" I don't know about you, but in many times in my life, as I was studying the scripture looking back, I thought there's many times I could have opened a message this way. But I've let opportunities pass, and maybe we all have. We've said, "Well, like this Samaritan woman, I probably shouldn't talk to them. I don't know if I should start a conversation with that person or that group of people. Might be better if I waited for friends or for somebody else. I don't know if I'm the person." But Jesus starts the conversation. "Woman, can you get me a drink?" And this woman, in the fashion most of us will find as we start to teach and share the gospel, looks at him and says, "I'm the wrong person. There's lots of reasons this isn't going to work out. But most importantly, the answer is, I can't give you a drink." But see, Jesus doesn't stop there. And I think that's where the Holy Spirit comes into play in our lives today as we celebrate Pentecost. Jesus knew the answer to give. Jesus looked at her and says, "If you would have known who was asking you this question, instead of telling them what you couldn't do, you would have asked me, what can you do for me?" As we look at this part of Scripture, it's where the Holy Spirit comes to play in our lives. Jesus asks us to go out and baptize. Jesus asks us to go out and teach people about Him in the gospel. But Jesus never tells us to do it on our own. Jesus tells us, "My Father is going to send someone who's going to guide you, teach you, fill you with knowledge and wisdom." That person coming is the Holy Spirit. And when Jesus talks about this living water, water that will fill you up from the inside so you're never thirsty again. The woman obviously doesn't understand that. She still looks at him and says, but I don't know how you're going to get that out of the well. And I've drank out of that well before and I still get thirsty. I have to come back. Tell me how to get this water so I don't have to walk to this well again. It's a long journey. And I think we look at our faith sometimes that way. You say to Jesus, how can I get this gift so I don't have to go out and do this anymore? Where can I get this great gift of spirit? Where can I get this gift of eternal life, of living water, so I don't have to do this anymore? And sometimes we take a back seat to ministry in our own lives. We step back. But Jesus tells this woman, I need you to go and tell people. And explains what the living water is. It's a gift, friends, we should all know. Living water is something that quenches us from the inside. It's not a drink we take. It's nothing that comes out of the tap. It's not in a glass that we have sitting on our desk or on our table. It's a living water that is inside us. It's this Holy Spirit that comes and fills the gaps and the holes in our life. It's a Holy Spirit that from within inside of us, as we ask God for guidance and for a way to move and a way to be, this Holy Spirit fills those things. It channels us. It teaches us. It's the Holy Spirit that comes to us when we say to somebody sitting at a table, hey, would you like something to drink? When they look at us and say, yeah, what do you got? The Holy Spirit is when we can pray and say, God, help me to have the right words, to know the right scripture, to be able to answer this person's questions in a way that is good and pleasing and opens the door to your will. That is the Holy Spirit that fills us, that moves within us. And friends, we celebrate it today on Pentecost. But Jesus looks at this woman and says, lady, I can help you free from everything. And I think it's appropriate in this scripture that sin is exposed. Not for Jesus to beat her down, but for Jesus to pick her up. He says to her, well, go and get your husband and come back. I'll tell you the story. She says, well, I don't have a husband. And how many of us would answer the question that way? Not 100% true. My mom used to tell me growing up that I never lied to her. I just never told her the whole story. How many of us have been there? We tell the good parts of the story, right? We leave out the parts that maybe weren't quite as good as we wanted them to be. Been there. And that's what this lady does. She forgets the whole story. I don't have a husband, Philip. He says to her, you're right. The fact is you've had five, and the one you have right now isn't your husband. What a way to get somebody's attention, right? Somebody you don't know. I would imagine at this point in time, the woman looked at him and said, you got me. And in fact, Jesus did. Jesus at that time probably could have said, I don't know if you're worthy, but Jesus didn't say that. Jesus said, you're my child, you're a daughter of the kingdom. And you don't have to worry about being a Samaritan anymore because I've come. I've bridged that gap. I've broken those barriers. The gospel, the Messiah, the giving, living water is for every person that comes to the well. Regardless of who you are entitled to this gift. Friends, today, Memorial Day, Pentecost, the day that we kind of kick off summer, the day that we kind of get ready for our lives to slow down maybe a little bit, for our routines to get a little less tense, for our kids, I know, to look and start counting down the last day that the bus is going to show up at the front door. I think it's appropriate that as we take time, as we take a deep breath in our own lives, we exhale and say it's summer. It is also a time that we get geared up for salvation. That we get prepared and get ready to share this amazing story that is the gospel. That we get ready in our own homes, in our own upper rooms, for the Holy Spirit to come and to fill us. Jesus changed this woman's life here. Verse 24, it says, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. Friends, I think it's important time in our life that we do take a break. Jesus said he's tired and he sat down at the well. But in that rest, in that moment of just sitting, Jesus didn't stop saving people's lives. He didn't stop blessing people with the gift of eternal life, with the gift of living water. So I would encourage us as we begin this summer, as we kick off the weekend, some barbecues, maybe some time out in the yard with kids, maybe just a day that we don't go to work, that we wouldn't stop doing the work of the Holy Spirit. That we wouldn't stop doing the work of salvation. That we wouldn't stop doing the work that God called us to when He said, go forth and baptize all nations, all people. Friends, we have a great gift to give. Our second letter, E, eat. We can do it around a table. It's a comfortable place. Just think of the conversations that can happen around a community bonfire tomorrow night. People talk about summertime and fireworks. And you talk about church. You might say, well, I don't know about church. You can say, well, hey, let's see what we do. We have a good time. It's a fun crowd to be around. We have a party everywhere we go. Because we have the most exciting thing in the world to be partying about. Eternal life. We have down days in our life. We have days that we don't feel real good. Bad things happen. It's life. But we know in the end that the Holy Spirit lifts us up above all those. We know that in the end we have the greatest gift of all, living water that never makes us thirsty again. And we can share that living water with you. Friends, a glass of tea, as Uncle Si would say, or a hamburger, a hot dog, a bag of chips sitting on a bench. It'd be amazing to see what conversations can start around those things. Jesus gives the example, hey, can I have a drink? What an easy way to start a conversation. And what an amazing way to change a life. Over a glass of tea, over a bottle of Coke, over something simple that we do every day that ministry happens in and around. Friends, this week as you go from this place, I would encourage you to ask the question, would you like something to drink that makes you thirsty never again? You'd be amazed at the questions you'll get back from that simple statement. Jesus changed a woman's life. He opened a ministry to an entire community that hadn't heard anything for centuries. He changed the life of a woman who then went out and changed the lives of many in her community. It starts with one. So friends, this weekend, as we begin summer, I would encourage you to remember and thank our veterans. They're the reason we have some of this freedom to go out and share this gospel message. I would encourage you to think about the Holy Spirit. Just stop and breathe. Take a breath, a deep one. Say, God, let me feel that Spirit within me. And listen. As you do that this weekend, prepare for an exciting summer. God has things planned. I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how. But I know that God has a plan for each and every one of us. Let us hold up one another in that plan. Let us pray for each other as we go forward. And let us break bread together, sharing around the table the great gift of salvation in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Dear Father, we come to you today asking that you would be with us and guide us, that you would lift us up in your hands, that you would help us too, Father, to share this gift of salvation. As you shared it to a lonely woman in a well, that we would take, we would share it to those that we meet in our lives. Father, as we break bread together, as we sit around tables, that the gift of conversation would be the gift of you, the gift of eternal life and salvation, the gift of living water. We pray these things in your name, Lord. Amen.